PREFACE. The Great World War was more than two-thirds over when America entered the struggle, and yet, in a sense, this country was in the war from its very beginning. Three great inventions controlled the character of the fighting and made it different from any other the world has ever seen. These three inventions were American. The submarine was our invention. It carried the war into the sea. The airplane was an American invention. It carried the war into the sky. We invented the machine gun. It drove the war into the ground. It is not my purpose to boast of American genius, but rather to show that we entered the war with heavy responsibilities. The inventions we had given to the world had been developed marvelously in other lands. Furthermore, they were in the hands of a determined and unscrupulous foe, and we found before us the task of overcoming the very machines that we had created. Yankee ingenuity was faced with a real test. The only way of overcoming the airplane was to build more and better machines than the enemy possessed. This we tried to do, but first we had to be taught by our allies the latest refinements of this machine, and the war was over before we had more than started our aerial program. The machine gun and its accessory barbed wire, also an American invention, were overcome by the tank, and we may find what little comfort we can in the fact that its invention was inspired by the sight of an American farm tractor. But the tank was a British creation and was undoubtedly the most important invention of the war. On the sea, we were faced with a most baffling problem. The U-boat could not be coped with by the building of swarms of submarines. The essential here was a means of locating the enemy and destroying him, even when he lurked under the surface. Two American inventions, the hydrophone and the depth bomb, made the lot of the U-boat decidedly unenviable, and they hastened, if they did not actually end, German frightfulness on the sea. But these were by no means the only inventions of the war. Great Britain showed wonderful ingenuity and resourcefulness in many directions. France did marvels with the airplane and showed great cleverness in her development of the tank, and there was a host of minor inventions to her credit, while Italy showed marked skill in the creation of large airplanes and small sea craft. The Central Powers, on the other hand, were less originative, but showed marked resourcefulness in developing the inventions of others. Forts were made valueless by the large portable Austrian guns. The long-range gun that shelled Paris was a sensational achievement, but it cannot be called a great invention because it was of little military value. The great German Zeppelins were far from a success because they depended for their buoyancy on a highly inflammable gas. It is interesting to note that while the Germans were acknowledging the failure of their dirigibles, the British were launching an airship program, and here in America we had found an economical way of producing a non-inflammable balloon gas, which promises a great future for aerial navigation. The most important German contribution to the war, it cannot be classed as an invention, was poison gas, and it was not long ere they regretted this infraction of the rules of civilized warfare adopted at the Hague Conference, for the Allies soon gave them a big dose of their own medicine, and before the war was over, fairly deluged them with lethal gases of every variety. Many inventions of our own and of our allies were not fully developed when the war ended, and there were some which, although primarily intended for purposes of war, will be most serviceable in time of peace. For this war was not one of mere destruction. It set men to thinking as they had never thought before. It intensified their inventive faculties, and as a result the world is richer in many ways. Lessons of thrift and economy have been taught us. Manufacturers have learned the value of standardization. The businessman has gained an appreciation of scientific research. The whole story is too big to be contained within the covers of a single book, but I have selected the more important and interesting inventions and have endeavored to describe them in simple language for the benefit of the reader who is not technically trained. A. Russell Bond, New York, May 1919. Chapter 1. The War in and Under the Ground. For years the Germans had been preparing for war. The whole world knew this, but it had no idea how elaborate were their preparations, and how these were carried out to the very minutest detail. When the call to arms was sounded, it was a matter of only a few hours before a vast army had been assembled, fully armed, completely equipped, ready to swarm over the frontiers into Belgium, and thence into France. It took much longer for the French to raise their armies of defense, and still longer for the British to furnish France with any adequate help. Despite the heroic resistance of Belgium, the Entente Allies were unprepared to stem the tide of German soldiers who poured into the northern part of France. So easy did the march to Paris seem that the Germans grew careless in their advance, and then suddenly they met with a reverse that sent them back in full retreat. However, the military authorities of Germany had studied not only how to attack, but also how to retreat and how to stand on the defensive. In this, as in every other phase of the conflict, they were far in advance of the rest of the world, and after their defeat in the First Battle of the Marne, they retired to a strong position and hastily prepared to stand on the defensive. When the Allies tried to drive them farther back, they found that the German army had simply sunk into the ground. The war of maneuver had given away to trench warfare, which lasted through long, tedious months nearly to the end of the great conflict. The Germans found it necessary to make the stand because the Russians were putting up such a strong fight on Germany's eastern frontier. Men had to be withdrawn from the western front to stem the Russian tide, which meant that the western armies of the Kaiser had to cease their offensive activities for the time being. The delay was fatal to the Germans, for they had opposed to them not only brave men, but intelligent men who were quick to learn. And when the Germans were ready to resume operations in the west, they found that the Allies also had sunk into the ground and had learned all their tricks of trench warfare, adding a number of new ones of their own. The whole character of the war was changed. The opposing forces were deadlocked, and neither could break through the other's lines. The idea of digging into the ground did not originate with this war, but never before had it been carried out on so extensive a scale. The inventive faculties of both sides were vainly exercised to find some way of breaking the deadlock. Hundreds of new inventions were developed. The history of war from the days of the ancient Romans up to the present time was searched for some means of breaking down the opposing lines. However, the deadlock was not broken until a special machine had been invented, a traveling fort. But the story of that machine is told in another chapter. At the outset, the Allies dug very shallow ditches, such as had been used in previous wars. When it was found that these burrows would have to be occupied for weeks and months, the French and British imitated the Germans and dug their trenches so deep that men could walk through them freely, without danger of exposing their heads above ground. And as the ditches grew deeper, they had to be provided with a firing step, on which the riflemen could stand to fire over the top of the trenches. The trenches were zigzagged so that they could not be flanked, otherwise they would have made dangerous traps for the defenders, for had the enemy gained one end of the trench, he could have fired down the full length of it, killing or wounding every man it contained. But zigzagging made it necessary to capture each turn separately. There were lines upon lines of these trenches. Ordinarily, there were but three lines, several hundred feet apart, with communicating trenches connecting them, and then several kilometers further back were reserved trenches, also connected by communicating trenches with the front lines. Men did not dare to show themselves out in the open near the battlefront for a mile or more behind the front-line trenches, for the enemy sharpshooters were always on the watch for a target. The men had to stay in the trenches day and night for two or more weeks at a time, and sleeping accommodations of a very rough sort were provided for them in dugouts which opened into the trenches. The dugouts of the Allies were comparatively crude affairs, but the Germans spent a great deal of time upon their burrows. Underground villages. When the French first swept the Germans back out of their trenches along the Aisne, they were astonished to find how elaborate were these underground dwellings. They found that the ground was literally honeycombed with rooms and passageways. Often the dugouts were two stories in depth and extended as much as 60 feet below the level of the ground. In fact, all along this part of the front, the Germans had a continuous underground village in which thousands of men were maintained. The officers' quarters were particularly well fitted up, and every attention was given to the comfort of their occupants. There were steel doormats at the entrances of the quarters. The walls were boarded and even papered. The bedrooms were fitted with spring beds, chiffoniers, and washstands, and all the rooms were lighted with electric lamps. There were spacious quarters for the men, with regular underground mess halls and elaborate kitchens. There were power plants to furnish steam for the operation of pumps and for the lighting plants and for other purposes. There was a chalk formation here in which were many large natural caves. One enormous cave was said to have held 30,000 soldiers, and in this section the Germans kept large reserve forces. By digging far into the ground, the German troops secured protection from shell fire. In fact, the horrible noise of battle was heard only as a murmur down in these depths. With characteristic thoroughness, the Germans built their trench system for a long stay, while the Allies, on the other hand, looked upon their trenches as merely temporary quarters, which would hold the enemy at bay until they could build up armies large enough to drive the invaders out of the country. The construction of the trenches along some parts of the battle line was particularly difficult because of the problem of drainage. This was especially true in Flanders, where the trenches in many cases were below water level, and elaborate pumping systems had to be installed to keep them dry. Some of them were concrete-lined to make them waterproof. In the early stages of the war, before the trenches were drained, the men had to stand in water for a good part of the time, and the only way they could get about at all in the miry trenches was by having duck boards in them. Duck boards are sections of wooden sidewalk such as we find in small villages in this country, consisting of a couple of rails on which cross pieces of wood are nailed. These duck boards fairly floated in the mud. Some of the trenches were provided with barbed wire barriers or gates calculated to halt a raiding party if it succeeded in getting into the trench. These gates were swung up out of the way, but when lowered they were kept closed with a rather complicated system of bolts which the enemy would be unable to unfasten without some delay. And while he was struggling to get through the gate, he would be a target for the bullets of the defenders. Hiding railroads in ditches. Because of the elaborate system of trenches and the distance from the front line to that part of the country where it was safe to operate in the open, it was necessary to build railways which would travel through tunnels and communicating trenches to the front lines. These were narrow-gauge railroads, and a special standard form of track section was designed, which was entirely of metal, something like the track sections of toy railroads. The tracks were very quickly laid and taken up at need. The locomotives had to be silent and smokeless, and so a special form of gasoline locomotive was invented to haul the little cars along these miniature railroads to the front lines. Usually the trench railroads did not come to the very front of the battle line, but their principal use was to carry shell to the guns which were located in concealed positions. Railroads or tramway trenches could not be sharply zigzagged, but had to have easy curves, which were apt to be recognized by enemy airplanes, and so they were often concealed under a covering of wire strewn with leaves. Periscopes and sniper scopes. But while the armies were buried underground, it was necessary for them to keep their eyes upon each other so that each might be ready for any sudden onslaught of the other. Snipers were always ready to fire at any head that showed itself above the parapet of the trench, and so the soldiers had to steal an idea from the submarines and build them periscopes with which they could look over the top of their trenches without exposing themselves. A trench periscope was a very simple affair, consisting of a tube with two mirrors, one at the top and one at the bottom, set at such an angle that a person looking into the side of the tube at the bottom could see out of the opposite side of the tube at the top. Observation posts were established wherever there was a slight rise in the ground. Sometimes these posts were placed far in advance of the trenches, and sometimes even behind the trenches, where it was possible to obtain a good view of the opposing lines. Sometimes a tunnel would be dug forward, leading to an outlet close to the enemy's lines, and here an observer would take his position at night to spy with his ears upon the activities of the enemy. Observers who watched the enemy by day would often not dare to use periscopes, which might be seen by the enemy, and draw a concentrated fire of rifles and even shell, so that every manner of concealment was employed to make the observation posts invisible and to have them blend with their surroundings. Observers even wore veils so that the white of their skin would not betray them. Snipers were equally ingenious in concealing themselves. They frequently used rifles which were connected with a dummy butt and had a periscope sighting attachment. This attachment was called a sniperscope. The rifle barrel could be pushed through a loophole in the parapet, and the sniper, standing safely below the parapet, could hold the dummy butt to his shoulder and aim his rifle with perfect accuracy by means of the periscope. It was next to impossible to locate a sniper hidden in this way. One method of doing it was to examine rubbish, tin cans, or any other object that had been penetrated by a bullet and note the direction taken by the bullet. This would give a line leading toward the source of the shot, and when a number of such lines were traced, they would cross at a point where the sniper or his gun was stationed, and a few shell would put the man out of business. Dummy heads of papier-mâché were sometimes stuck above the parapets to draw the fire of enemy snipers, and the bullet holes which quickly appeared in them were studied to discover the location of snipers. Sometimes fixed rifles were used. These were set on stands so that they could be very accurately trained upon some important enemy post. Then they could be fired in the dark without aiming to disturb night operations of the enemy. Often a brace of rifles, as many as six, would be coupled up to be fired simultaneously, and by operating a single lever each gun could throw out the empty cartridge shell and bring a fresh one into position. Steel briar patches. The most important defense of a trench system consisted in the barbed wire entanglements placed before it. Barbed wire, by the way, is an American invention, but it was originally intended for the very peaceful purpose for keeping cattle within bounds. Long ago it was used in war, but never to the extent to which it was employed in this world struggle. The entanglements were usually set up at night and were merely fences consisting of stout posts driven into the ground and strung with barbed wire running in all directions so as to make an impenetrable tangle. Where it was possible to prepare the entanglements without disturbance, and the position was an important one, the mass of barbed wire often extended for 100 yards or more in depth. Just beyond the entanglements, trip wires were sometimes used. A trip wire was a slack wire which was laid on the ground. Before being laid, the wire was tightly coiled so that it would not lie flat, but would catch the feet of raiders and trip them up. Each side had gates in the line through which this wire could quickly be removed to let its own raiding parties through. Sometimes raiders used tunnels with outlets beyond the barbed wire, but they had to cut their way through the metal briar patches of their opponents. Early in the war, various schemes were devised for destroying the entanglements. There were bombs in the form of a rod about 12 feet long, which could be pushed under the wire and, upon exploding, would tear it apart. Another scheme was to fire a projectile formed like a grapnel. The projectile was attached to the end of a cable and was fired from a small gun in the same way that lifelines are thrown out to wrecks near shore. Then the cable would be wound up on a winch, and the grapnel hooks would tear the wire from its fastenings. Such schemes, however, did not prove very practicable, and it was eventually found that a much better way of destroying barbed wire was to bombard it with high-explosive shell, which would literally blow the wire apart. But it required a great deal of shelling to destroy these entanglements, and it was really not until the tank was invented that such obstructions could be flattened out so that they formed no bar to the passage of the soldiers. The Germans not only used fixed entanglements, but they had large standard sections of barbed wire arranged in the form of big cylindrical frames, which could be carried easily by a couple of men and could be placed in position at a moment's notice to close a gap in the line or even to build up new lines of wire obstruction. Mines and countermines. In the earlier stages of the war, it proved so impossible to capture a trench when it was well defended by machine guns that efforts were made to blow up the enemy by means of mines. Tunnels were dug reaching out under the enemy's lines, and large quantities of explosives were stored in them. At the moment when it was intended to make an assault, there would be a heavy cannonading to disconcert the enemy, and then the mine would be touched off. In the demoralizing confusion that resulted, the storming party would sweep over the enemy. Such mines were tried on both sides, and the only protection against them was to outguess the other side and build countermines. If it were suspected, from the importance of a certain position and the nature of the ground, that the enemy would probably try to undermine it, the defenders would dig tunnels of their own towards the enemy, at a safe distance beyond their own lines, and establish listeners there to see if they could hear the mining operations of their opponents. Very delicate microphones were used, which the listeners would place on the ground or against the walls of their tunnel. Then they would listen for the faintest sound of digging, just as a doctor listens through a stethoscope to the beating of a patient's heart or the rush of air through his lungs. When these listening instruments picked up the noise of digging, the general direction of the digging could be followed out by placing the instrument at different positions and noting where the noise was loudest. Then a countermine would be extended in that direction, far enough down to pass under the enemy's tunnel, and at the right moment a charge of TNT, trinitrotoluol, would be exploded, which would destroy the enemy's sappers and put an end to their ambitious plans. A very interesting case of mining was furnished by the British when they blew up the important post of Messines Ridge. This was strongly held by the Germans, and the only way of dislodging the enemy was to blow off the top of the ridge. Before work was started, geologists were called upon to determine whether or not the ground was suitable for mining operations. They picked out a spot where the digging was good from the British side, but where, if countermines were attempted from the German side, quicksands would be encountered and tunneling of any sort would be difficult. The British sappers could, therefore, proceed with comparative safety. The Germans suspected that something of the sort was being undertaken, but they found it very difficult to dig countermines. However, one day their suspicions were confirmed when the whole top of the hill was blown off with a big loss of German lives. In the assault that followed, the British captured the position, and it was annexed to the British lines. Chapter 2. Hand Grenades and Trench Mortars. In primitive times, battles were fought hand to hand. The first implements of war were clubs and spears and battle axes, all intended for fighting at close quarters. The bow and arrow enabled men to fight at a distance. But shields and armor were so effective a defense that it was only by hand-to-hand fighting that a brave enemy could be defeated. Even the invention of gunpowder did not separate the combatants permanently, for although it was possible to hurl missiles at a great distance, cannon were so slow in their action that the enemy could rush them between shots. Shoulder firearms also were comparatively slow in the early days and liable to misfire. And it was not until the automatic rifle of recent years was fully developed that soldiers learned to keep their distance. When the great European war started, military authorities had come to look upon war at close quarters as something relegated to bygone days. Even the bayonet was beginning to be thought of little use. Rifles could be charged and fired so rapidly, and machine-guns could play such a rapid tattoo of bullets, that it seemed impossible for men to come near enough for hand-to-hand fighting, except at a fearful cost of life. In developing the rifle, every effort was made to increase its range so that it could be used with accuracy at a distance of 1,000 yards and more. But when the Germans, after their retreat in the First Battle of the Marne, dug themselves in behind the Aisne, and the French and British, too, found it necessary to seek shelter from machine-gun and rifle fire by burrowing into the ground, it became apparent that while rifles and machine-guns could drive the fighting into the ground, they were of little value in continuing the fight after the opposing sides had buried themselves. The trenches were carried close to one another, in some instances being so close that the soldiers could actually hear the conversation of their opponents across the intervening gap. Under such conditions, long-distance firearms were of very little practical value. What was needed was a short-distance gun which would get down into the enemy trenches. To be sure, the trenches could be shelled, but the shelling had to be conducted from a considerable distance, where the artillery would be immune to attack, and it was impossible to give a trench the particular and individual attention which it would receive at the hands of men attacking it at close quarters. Before we go any farther, we must learn the meaning of the word trajectory. No bullet or shell travels in a straight line. As soon as it leaves the muzzle of the gun, it begins to fall, and its course through the air is a vertical curve that brings it eventually down to the ground. This curve is called the trajectory. No gun is pointed directly at a target, but above it, so as to allow for the pull of gravity. The faster the bullet travels, the flatter is this curve or trajectory, because there is less time for it to fall before it reaches its target. Modern rifles fire their missiles at so high a speed that the bullets have a very flat trajectory. But in trench warfare, a flat trajectory was not desired. What was the use of a missile that traveled in a nearly straight line when the object to be hit was hiding in the ground? Trench fighting called for a missile that had a very high trajectory, so that it would drop right into the enemy trench. Hand artillery. Trench warfare is really a close-quarters fight of fort against fort, and the soldiers who manned the forts had to revert to the ancient methods of fighting an enemy entrenched behind fortifications. Centuries ago, not long after the first use of gunpowder in war, small explosive missiles were invented which could be thrown by hand. These were originally known as flying mortars. The missile was about the size of an orange or a pomegranate, and it was filled with powder and slugs. A small fuse, which was ignited just before the device was thrown, was timed to explode the missile when it reached the enemy. Because of its size and shape, and because the slugs it contained corresponded in a manner to the pulp-covered seeds with which a pomegranate is filled, the missile was called a grenade. Grenades had fallen out of use in modern warfare, although they had been revived to a small extent in the Russo-Japanese War and had been used with some success by the Bulgarians and the Turks in the Balkan Wars. And yet they had not been taken very seriously by the military powers of Europe, except Germany. Germany was always on the lookout for any device that might prove useful in war, and when the Germans dug themselves in after the First Battle of the Marne, they had great quantities of hand grenades for their men to toss over into the trenches of the Allies. These missiles proved very destructive indeed. They took the place of artillery and were virtually hand-thrown shrapnel. The French and British were entirely unprepared for this kind of fighting, and they had hastily to improvise offensive and defensive weapons for trench warfare. Their hand grenades were at first merely tin cans filled with bits of iron and a high explosive, in which a fuse cord was inserted. The cord was lighted by means of a cigarette, and then the can with its sputtering fuse was thrown into the enemy lines. As time went on and the art of grenade fighting was learned, the first crude missiles were greatly improved upon, and grenades were made in many forms for special service. There was a difference between grenades hurled from sheltered positions and those used in open fighting. When the throwers were sheltered behind their own breastworks, it mattered not how powerful was the explosion of the grenade. We must remember that in hand artillery the shell is far more powerful in proportion to the distance it is thrown than the shell fired from a gun, and many grenades were so heavily charged with explosives that they would scatter death and destruction farther than they could be thrown by hand. The grenadier who cast one of these grenades had to duck under cover or hide under the walls of his trench, else the fragments scattered by the exploding missile might fly back and injure him. Some grenades would spread destruction to a distance of over 300 feet from the point of explosion. For close work, grenades of smaller radius were used. These were employed to fight off a raiding party after it had invaded a trench, and the destructive range of these grenades was usually about 25 feet. Hand grenades came to be used in all the different ways that artillery was used. There were grenades which were filled with gas, not only of the suffocating and tear-producing types, but also of the deadly poisonous variety. There were incendiary grenades which would set fire to enemy stores, and smoke grenades which would produce a dense black screen behind which operations could be concealed from the enemy. Grenades were used in the same way that shrapnel was used to produce a barrage or curtain of fire, through which the enemy could not pass without facing almost certain death. Curtains of fire were used not only for defensive purposes when the enemy was attacking, but also to cut off a part of the enemy so that it could not receive assistance and would be obliged to surrender. In attacks upon the enemy lines, grenades were used to throw a barrage in advance of the attacking soldiers so as to sweep the ground ahead clear of the enemy. The French paid particular attention to the training of grenadiers. A man had to be a good, cool-headed pitcher before he could be classed as a grenadier. He must be able to throw his grenade with perfect accuracy up to a distance of 70 yards and to maintain an effective barrage. The grenadier carried his grenades in large pockets attached to his belt, and he was attended by a carrier who brought up grenades to him in a basket, so that he was served with a continuous supply. Long-distance grenade throwing. All this relates to short-distance fighting, but grenades were also used for ranges beyond the reach of the pitcher's arm. Even back in the 16th century, the range of the human arm was not great enough to satisfy the combatants, and grenadiers used a throwing implement, something like a shovel, with which the grenade was slung to a greater distance, in much the same way as a lacrosse ball is thrown. Later, grenades were filled with light, flexible wooden handles, and were thrown, handle and all, at the enemy. By this means they could be slung to a considerable distance. Such grenades were used in the recent war, particularly by the Germans. The handle was provided with streamers so as to keep the grenade head-on to the enemy, and it was usually exploded by percussion on striking its target. These long-handled grenades, however, were clumsy and bulky, and the grenadier required a good deal of elbow room when throwing them. A much better plan was to hurl them with the aid of a gun. A rifle made an excellent short-distance mortar. With it, grenades could be thrown from 300 to 400 yards. The grenade was fastened on a rod which was inserted in the barrel of the rifle, and then it was fired out of the gun by the explosion of a blank cartridge. The butt of the rifle was rested on the ground, and the rifle was tilted so as to throw the grenade up into the air in the way that a mortar projects its shell. Striking a light. The lighting of the grenade fuses with a cigarette did very well for the early tin-can grenades, but the cigarettes were not always handy, particularly in the heat of battle, and something better had to be devised. One scheme was to use a safety match composition on the end of a fuse. This was covered with waxed paper to protect it from the weather. The grenadier wore an armlet covered with a friction composition such as is used on a safety match box. Before the grenade was thrown, the waxed paper was stripped off, and the fuse was lighted by being scratched on the armlet. In another type, the fuse was lighted by the twisting of a cap which scratched a match composition on a friction surface. A safety pin kept the cap from turning until the grenadier was ready to throw the grenade. The Mills hand grenade, which proved to be the most popular type used by the British Army, was provided with a lever which was normally strapped down and held by means of a safety pin. Figure 4 shows a sectional view of this grenade. Just before the missile was thrown, it was seized in the hand so that the lever was held down. Then the safety pin was removed, and when the grenade was thrown, the lever would spring up under the pull of the spring. This would cause the pin to strike the percussion cap, which would light the fuse. The burning fuse would eventually carry the fire to the detonator, which would touch off the main explosive, shattering the shell of the grenade and scattering its fragments in all directions. The shell of the grenade was indented so that it would break easily into a great many small pieces. There were some advantages in using grenades lighted by fuse instead of percussion, and also there were many disadvantages. If too long a time fuse were used, the enemy might catch the grenade as you would catch a baseball and hurl it back before it exploded. This was a hazardous game, but it was often done. Among the different types of grenades which the Germans used was one provided with a parachute, as shown in Figure 5. The object of the parachute was to keep the head of the grenade toward the enemy, so that when it exploded it would expend its energies forward and would not cast fragments back toward the man who had thrown it. This was a very sensitive grenade, arranged to be fired by percussion, but it was so easily exploded that the firing mechanism was not released until after the grenade had been thrown. In the handle of this grenade there was a bit of cord about 20 feet long. One end of this was attached to a safety needle, while the other end, formed into a loop, was held by the grenadier when he threw the grenade. Not until the missile had reached a height of 12 or 13 feet would the pull of the string withdraw the needle. This would permit a safety hook to drop out of a ring on the side of a striker pellet. When the grenade struck, the pellet would move forward and a pin would strike a cap on the detonator, exploding the missile. This form of safety device was used on a number of German grenades. The British had another scheme for locking the mechanism until after the grenade had traveled some distance through the air. Details of this grenade, which was of the type adopted to be fired from a rifle, are shown in Figure 6. The striker is retained by a couple of bolts, which in turn are held in place by a sleeve. On the sleeve is a set of wind vanes. As the grenade travels through the air, the wind vanes cause the sleeve to revolve, screwing it down clear of the bolts, which then drop out, permitting the pin to strike the detonator upon impact of the grenade with its target. The Germans had one peculiar type, which was in the shape of a disc. In the disc were 6 tubes, 4 of which carried percussion caps, so that the grenade was sure to explode no matter on which tube it fell. The disc was thrown with the edge up, and it would roll through the air. Another type of grenade was known as the hairbrush grenade, because it had a rectangular body of tin about 6 inches long and 2 3/4 inches wide and deep, which was nailed to a wooden handle. Miniature artillery. Hand artillery was very effective as far as it went, but it had its limitations. Grenades could not be made heavier than 2 pounds in weight if they were to be thrown by hand. In fact, most of them were much lighter than that. If they were fired from a rifle, the range was increased, but the missile could not be made very much heavier. TNT is a very powerful explosive, but there is not room for much of it in a grenade the size of a large lemon. Trench fighting was a duel between forts, and while the hand artillery provided a means of attacking the defenders of a fort, it made no impression on the walls of the fort. It corresponded to shrapnel fire on a miniature scale, and something corresponding to high explosive fire on a small scale was necessary if the opposing fortifications were to be destroyed. To meet this problem, men cast their thoughts back to the primitive artillery of the Romans, who used to hurl great rocks at the enemy with catapults, and the trench fighters actually rigged up catapults with which they hurled heavy bombs at the enemy lines. All sorts of ingenious catapults were built, some modeled after the old Roman machines. In some of these, stout timbers were used as springs, in others there were powerful coil springs. It was not necessary to cast the bombs far. For distant work, the regular artillery could be used. What was needed was a short-distance gun for heavy missiles, and that is what the catapult was. But the work of the catapult was not really satisfactory. The machine was clumsy, it occupied too much space, and it could not be aimed very accurately. It soon gave way to a more modern apparatus, fashioned after the old smoothbore mortars. This was a miniature mortar, short and wide-mouthed. A rifled barrel was not required, because, since the missile was not to be hurled far, it was not necessary to set it spinning by means of riflings so as to hold it head-on to the wind. Giant pea-shooters. Better aim was secured when a longer-barreled trench mortar came to be used. In the trench, weight was an important item. There was no room in which to handle heavy guns, and the mortar had to be portable so that it could be carried forward by the infantry in a charge. As the walls of a light barrel might be burst by the shock of exploding powder, compressed air was used instead. The shell was virtually blown out of the gun in the same way that a boy blows missiles out of a pea-shooter. That the shell might be kept from tumbling, it was fitted with vanes at the rear. These acted like the feathers of an arrow to hold the missile head-on to its course. The French, in particular, used this type of mortar, and the air pump was used to compress the air that propelled the shell or aerial torpedo, or else the propelling charge was taken from a compressed air tank. Carbon dioxide, the gas used in soda water, is commonly stored in tanks under high pressure, and this gas was sometimes used in place of compressed air. When the gas in the tank was exhausted, the latter could be recharged with air by using a hand pump. 200 or 300 strokes of the pump would give a pressure of 120 to 150 pounds per inch, and would supply enough air to discharge a number of shell. The air was let into the barrel of the mortar in a single puff, sufficient to launch the shell. Then the tank was cut off at once, so that the air it contained would not escape and go to waste. The Stokes mortar. However, the most useful trench mortar developed during the war was invented by Wilfred Stokes, a British inventor. In this, a comparatively slow-acting powder was used to propel the missile, and so a thin-walled barrel could be used. The light Stokes mortar can easily be carried over the shoulder by one man. It has two legs, and the barrel itself serves as a third leg, and the mortar stands like a tripod. The two legs are adjustable so that the barrel can be inclined to any desired angle. It took but a moment to set up the mortar for action in a trench or shell hole. Curiously enough, there is no breech block, trigger, or fire hole in this mortar. It is fired merely by the dropping of the missile into the mouth of the barrel. The shell carries its own propelling.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.